Give it up for Lewis Horn.
No. You're sensing me. You don't perceive me. Perception is reality, Eva.
Give a warm round of applause to our next guest, Steve Wozniak.
The Tesla really was the seed that caused it all to happen. Who would ever build an electric car large?
Welcome everyone to Uniti Update episode 10. Today we have a really exciting episode in front of us.
A lot of things have been going on lately. We've partly gone to Australia to look at new opportunities, which we'll show you later in this episode. And we've also been at the Road and Transport Institute of Sweden to do a collaboration on our heads-up display.
But first we want to show you when we went to CubeTech Fair in Berlin, where Lewis had a speech just before Steve Wozniak with the robot on stage.
So now let's check all that out. So we're in Berlin now. Lewis is going to have a speech at the CubeTech Fair where he's going to have a video behind him, and beside him there's going to be a robot that's going to move around and do different movements with Lewis's speech. Pretty cool stuff.
So we are here in our temporary workshop where we're setting up the robot Eva. She's going to participate in Lewis's speech tomorrow.
And then be talking. What do you say, Eva? And then she nods.
Can simulate robot movements and everything.
And it's a small room with a live robot.
Oh, okay. So we gotta upload some code to the eyes.
Writing. Done uploading.
Yeah,
eye surgery, yes.
Det går skitbra!
And now we're sitting on the 10th floor of the hotel working on the last animations, which are going to be behind Lewis on his speech tour. This is the plan for the animation here.
Yeah, the sun is shining.
Kevin's a little stressed out.
I clean my bloody bag, got squash banana all over the inside of my bag.
So what do you do, Kevin?
Great fucking awesome animations. We're very close to finishing, but there's still a lot to do.
At CubeTech Fair in Berlin.
He is the CEO of an electric car company, and this is a company that is launching a fully automated factory from a digital platform. Give it up for Lewis Horn.
It's great to be here in Berlin, such a badass city. I'm here with a whole bunch of epic teammates from Sweden. And up there in Sweden, we are reinventing a piece of the world, the electric car. We have optimized the machine for its Achilles heel, which of course is the battery. We're not designing for the same old kind of car culture values, but designing for a new kind of values. Designing for things that people want today, like more processing power. This machine is a piece of electronics. It is not a car. We start entirely in this digital world, and what we create starts to take shape. The physical world is merely a direct representation, a manifestation of the digital world. It's a completely different world that's highly flexible and obviously highly scalable, because we don't have to involve the terribly difficult organization task of including humans in the process, the kind of dangerous, difficult job that I had to do. Humans should be creative, they should be inspired. If they're not inspired, they just get tired. Robots don't get tired. Wake up. Hello. Oh, hello. Oh, hi. Sorry, I woke you up. Is my speech boring you? Oh, okay. Thank you. You're not perceiving me now, though, right? No. You're sensing me. You don't perceive me. It's an exciting change. As I said, 50% of companies that try to digitize fail because of the cultural problem. If we can start afresh with our culture as a digital native, as a company, whilst we do have incredibly big disadvantages relative to a big car company, we also have advantages. On behalf of the team, anybody else out there that's fighting for something, we salute you. And I know that Steve Wozniak is here, so I just wanted to say thank you so much for building the first Apple computer with your bare hands. What a mighty seed that was. Thank you.
So there you had some snippets from Lewis's speech, and right after him, Steve Wozniak was speaking on the same stage, the co-founder of Apple.
And they got to talk in between their speeches about the future of tech and the future of mobility. Here's a clip from Steve Wozniak's speech just after that conversation.
We were talking about Elon Musk, one of the people that I admire very greatly. The Tesla Model S is the first time I did the first successful car company in the United States since 1927. The Tesla really was the seed that caused it all to happen. Who would ever build an electric car large? Turns out that engineering-wise, you always look at the formulas, try to make it small, lightweight, low distance, because of the expense of the batteries that you can't justify.
Okay, sorry, I would just like to interrupt here and get Lewis's answer on Steve Wozniak's question on why Tesla would make their first electric car large and heavy.
Yeah, so first of all, obviously we agree with Wozniak and many other people. It totally makes sense if you're making an electric car to make it light and lean. It just fits electric mobility much better, especially if the motivations are environmental or energy efficiency and so forth. But as Wozniak said, he did give one example, a possible solution for why Elon Musk was doing that, and that was because of his own context. His own context was back and forth from work, there's plenty of superchargers, he has lots of kids, he needs something to keep him safe. That same logic you could use to explain why we design our vehicle in this way that we do. People like us want to have an electric car, but we don't want to have a huge electric car. 2 tons of machinery is not needed for my needs or for your needs. And our other market, which is the second family car, the little car beside your Tesla or something else, you also don't need it to be a great big machine. It should also be designed for your actual usage patterns. But I think the real reason, or the main reason why Tesla made that electric car in the way that they did, they said themselves in an old documentary, in fact, that I saw many years ago, basically they said the Tesla Model S isn't the perfect electric car. It's just the one that everybody demands. The environmental problem is demand driven. So there's a huge market that is going to continue purchasing a premium sedan or just a normal family sedan. They're going to keep buying it. The demand is still there. So they had to build the same car, just make it significantly better. So big and shiny and looks great and it's faster than everybody else, but it's electric. So regardless of their motivations, they could tilt the market towards emission-free future, electric future, obviously. So they're just trying to solve a problem. Big companies, big car companies, or any other big companies, are not there to solve problems. When you're mature, you are profit maximizing. It is a legal requirement. But if you're a younger company like Tesla or any other entrepreneurs out there, certainly people like Elon Musk, we kind of live for solving problems. That's why we're here. And that's what they were trying to do. Build the machine that everybody wanted, just make it electric so they could tilt the market until the time is right to rethink the entire machine from the ground up. Of course, we think the time is right now for 2 main reasons. Number one, because in many markets, in many parts of the world, here in Europe, Asia, certain parts of America, they are really open to something new that makes more sense, a little bit more high-tech consumer electronics angle. And secondly, the technology has to be mature enough and common enough to achieve that. So I think that's why both all reasons are grounded in solving problems.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. But anyway, let's see what happened when Florian and Lewis crossed the equator and went to Australia to see what opportunities Uniti might have there.
Now guys want to make flying cars too.
So we haven't only gone to Berlin. Lewis and our CFO Florian went to Australia. The reason for this was that in Australia, recently a lot of factories have been closing down.
This is of course something that the government would like to prevent, and that's where Uniti comes into the picture. We could actually help Australia regain their automotive industry by producing cars partly in Australia, and that's why Flo and Lewis went there to discuss in more depth what this would actually mean in terms of government support, funding and timelines, etc.
Sorry that you guys couldn't be here.
So nothing is set in stone just yet. We're developing these relationships with these interesting people that we've met in Australia and seeing where we can go next. So we'll update you on how everything went and where we're going next with this phase of our company as soon as possible.
I just want to say hello to everyone back there in Sweden.
So we're really excited about what's going to happen in Australia, and we're looking forward to be able to update you on what's happening there.
However, in the meantime, we also visited VTI, the Road and Transport Research Institution of Sweden, to do a collaboration on our heads-up display. Because the heads-up display isn't just cool or fun, it can also increase safety dramatically.
For example, let's imagine that you're driving after your GPS system. Then normally you would have to look out and then look down on your GPS and then look out again. And then during the time you look at your GPS, you lose track on what's happening out on the road. But with the heads-up display, this can all be avoided and you can keep your eyes at the road at all times.
And that's not the only safety feature that the heads-up display has. You can also highlight objects that cross your vehicle path, making you more aware as a driver than in a traditional vehicle.
And the reason VTI is doing this with us is that they have a lot of experience on creating physical simulators. So we would create a physical prototype of the heads-up display in a car and then be able to verify the various safety increases of the HUD.
So we're closing in on Linköping, where we're gonna visit VTI, the Road and Transport Institute in Sweden.
Väg och transportforskningsinstitutet.
So they do research for various organizations.
Så gör man rätt med fordonsdynamik och sådär, då kan man ju komma väldigt långt med utvärderingen av körkänsla och så i en simulerad miljö.
So those were the current simulators at VTI. However, they're building a custom one for us.
And this was it for this episode. And we know that summer is coming up, but we will not stop working here, so you will see another episode coming out soon.
However, in the meantime, do like, comment, and subscribe, and see you next time.